And we are very delighted that this morning we will have a young rising Muslim scholar, Shaykh Yasir Qadhi, who dedicated a very good part of his time learning about Ibn Taymiyyah, and particularly the his treatise on Ta'arud al-Aql wa al-Naql, the reconciling reason and revelation. This, as I mentioned, is something that is one of the major themes for IIIT's initial intellectual project. Because we thought this is an area where the Muslims really need a new ijtihad if we were to bridge this gap between our tradition, our scripture, and the contemporary focus on reason and rationality. So this bridging makes it necessary to introduce the works of our traditional scholars to the new generations of Muslims and others who are concerned with this. There is no way for us to enter into debate with contemporary minds unless we do that. And we are very grateful that young scholars like Sheikh Yasir Qadhi are doing exactly this. He is now a lecturer at the Department of Religious Studies at Rhodes College in Memphis, Tennessee. But he's also teaching at Al-Maghrib. Yes, Al-Maghrib. He got traditional training at Al-Madina Institute, Al-Madina University in Saudi Arabia, and he is now doing his PhD at Yale University. So we welcome Sheikh Yasir to IIIT. We have, inshallah, until 12:30 when we'll have lunch, we'll give him an hour to present his lecture. The rest of the time will be for questions and answers and comments, and then we'll move to lunch, and hopefully we will finish around 1:30 or before then. So, Sheikh Yasir.
Inshallah. Before I begin, even though I was born in America, I'm Pakistani by blood, I need my tea. So I'm seeing people with tea here and it's distracting. You can get me tea and water, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. I'm very honored and humbled to be at IIIT. I grew up reading the works of IIIT back in the early 80s, mid 80s. Of course, Ismail Raja Faruqi Shaheed and Taha Jabal Alwan and others, their works have been of, you know, extreme interest to my generation growing up here in America. And I thank Allah Azza wa Jal for the opportunity to be addressing all of you here. It's a very, very big honor, and I don't just say that as a platitude. So I was invited to really discuss my doctoral dissertation, my PhD dissertation at Yale, which deals with Ibn Taymiyyah's work, the 11-volume work, Dar'u Ta'arud al-Aql wa al-Naql. In order to understand this work, we need to take a step back, obviously. We need to understand who wrote it, why did he write it, what was the context of his writing. So Ibn Taymiyyah wrote this book as a response to a book written by the most famous theologian of the Ash'ari creed before his generation, and that is Fakhr al-Dīn ar-Razī. And Fakhr al-Dīn ar-Razī was from Afghanistan, modern-day Afghanistan, and in the year 596 Hijra, 1200 CE, he wrote a book that was called Asas al-Taqdīs, or the Foundations of Sanctity, the Foundations of Sacredness. And he presented it to one of the sultans, one of the nephews of Ṣalāḥ al-Ayyūbi. His name is Abu Bakr ibn Ayyub. For 1,000 dinars he was given for this. And Ibn Taymiyyah wrote his Dar' al-Ta'arud as a response to this book, Asas al-Taqdīs. So what is this book, Asas al-Taqdīs? It's around 100 pages. Ibn Taymiyyah wrote the 11 volumes in response to this 100 pages. Now realize, back then, the controversies were very different than modern times. For many of us, they seem irrelevant, but in my opinion, they are not irrelevant, because even though the pieces are different, the puzzle is the same. Even though the issue might seem very little relevance, but the concept behind it is actually the same. Those days, they were interested in God's attributes. They were interested in predestination. They were interested in aspects of theology that, by and large, in modern Islam, is really something that is only discussed in, you know, small seminars here and there. It's not something that affects the masses. But back then, this is what the people were talking about. How do we understand God's attributes? When Allah says X, what does He mean by this? How do we understand Qadr? How do we understand other issues of theology? So, as you know, there are many multiple schools. There's the Mu'tazila school, there's the Ash'ari school, there's the Athari school. Ibn Taymiyyah obviously represents the Athari school. And he took on the Ash'ari school in this particular book and other schools as well, with regards to Allah's names and attributes in particular. What has this got to do with Aql and Naql? We go back to Fakhruddin al-Razi. What did al-Razi write in this book, Asas al-Taqdis? Ar-Razi writes that he begins the book with some intellectual premises. Of these intellectual premises is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot occupy space or be a body. And in Arabic, these are called jism or tahayyuz. You cannot occupy space or be a body. And then he proves this intellectually and rationally and even scripturally. Then he says, anytime the Quran suggests that Allah might possibly be a body or occupy space, the mind says, we cannot accept this verse at face value. And then the bulk of the book, which is around 60% of the book, 60 pages literally, the bulk of the book is a detailed analysis of specific ayat and ahadith dealing with Allah's names and attributes that he feels that we cannot accept this at face value. Jazakallah khair. It needs to be reinterpreted. So for example, just as an example, Allah's attribute, it's mentioned in the hadith in Sahih Bukhari and others that Allah laughs at a person who does such and such. ضحك الله. Allah laughs, right? So Fakhruddin al-Razi says, it is impossible to affirm laughing to God. And then he mentions the reasons why. And then he says, so what does laughing mean? Perhaps it could mean this, perhaps it could mean that. So he simply brings about a linguistic interpretation. Then he comes to the conclusion, and it is the conclusion that really Ibn Taymiyyah attacks. The conclusion, the chapter is entitled, if rational proofs contradict apparent textual proofs, what is to be done? Again, we're talking about Ar-Razi, not Ibn Taymiyyah now. If rational proofs, dala'il aqliya, contradicts dala'il naqliya, textual proofs, what is to be done? Fakhruddin Ar-Razi writes, and I quote directly from the book because this is the essence of what Ibn Taymiyyah then takes on. Know that if indubitable rational proofs, yani ilm yaqini, leads us to establish something, and then we find scriptural evidences that seems to conflict with our rational proofs, he says there are four possible scenarios. Number one, that both rational proofs and scripture be believed in. But this is what? Contradictory. So he says this is a logical impossibility. We can't do this. Number two, that the apparent meaning of the scripture be denied, but the rational proofs be accepted. So we reject the naql and accept the aql. He doesn't comment on this. Number three, that they both be denied. What's the problem of denying both? Both naql and aql are denied. Once again, it's a logical impossibility. Like, if you accept both or reject both, it's a logical impossibility, right? Number four, that the scripture be believed in, but the aql be denied. So these are the four logical proofs, right? The four logical ways. You either reject both, accept both, reject naql and accept aql, or accept naql and reject aql, right? Simple four logical possibilities. Now, he says, and I quote here, that if we were to accept the meanings of the scripture and belie our intellect, this in fact is a rejection of the scripture as well. Okay? How so? Because we only know the truth of the scripture from our intellect. So if we reject our aql and accept naql, this, he says, is tantamount to rejecting both. Do you understand this point? It's a very crucial point for Fakhruddin al-Razi. What tells us the Quran is Kalamullah, our Aql? Now, if then we were to take the Aql and say, okay, we believe the Quran is Kalamullah, we believe the Hadith, we believe the Prophet is a Rasul. Now we find a Quran or Hadith that goes against our Aql. So we say, okay, I'll just accept the Naql and reject what my Aql says, that the Naql cannot be valid. By rejecting the Aql in this case, Fakhruddin al-Razi writes, in fact, we have tarnished the reputation of the Aql in accepting the Naql in the first place. Right? The faculty of reason has diminished in its value and has become tainted. How then do we know that the Naql is true if we're going to doubt the Aql for something else? Right? So Fakhruddin al-Razi basically writes, therefore, when all four possibilities are impossible, so for him all four are impossible, right? So these four logical possibilities, all four are impossible. He says nothing remains except, because why is, of course, you cannot reject Naql because that's kufr, right? He doesn't even comment because it's understood. You cannot reject Naql because that is not Islam, right? So what is then the only possibility? So he says we have to invent a fifth possibility, right? So he's very honest here that logically there's four possibilities. But all four are not possible, meaning they're not feasible to believe in, right? So then what does that force us to do? It forces us to bring forth a fifth possibility, which is what? That we affirm the Aql and then believe that the Naql means something other than what it says it means. Okay? We affirm the Aql, that we don't reject the Naql, but we take the naql, and naql of course means scripture or hadith, right? Transmitter reports. We take the naql and then we conform it to the aql, right? The meanings of the naql have to be reinterpreted in accordance with what the aql says. And then he says we can do this in one of two ways, by the way. He says the first of them is we don't really wonder or care about the actual meaning, and we do what is called by the scholars of kalam tafweed. And tafweed means Allah knows what these mean. Like alif, lam, mim, ham, mim, ayn, sin, qaf, noon. Just tafweed. We don't know what it means. So when Allah says something that the aql seems to contradict, we just say Allah knows what it means. We don't know. And of course, in those days, as I said, the issue was Allah's asma wa sifat, right? Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arshi istawa and dhahika Allah and whatnot. So they would say, look, whatever it means, it doesn't mean its literal meaning. We really don't have to worry about its real meaning. Just alif, lam, mim, ham, mim, ayn, sin, qaf. This is the first interpretation. This is tafwil. Or he says we have another way of doing this, and this is ta'wil. And ta'wil means reinterpretation, right? So, ar-Rahmanu ala al-arsh istawa, the ever-merciful has risen over the throne, actually means that Allah has conquered the dominion of the heavens and earth. The whole heavens and earth is under his control, right? Istawla. Istawla and arsh is symbolic for the creation. Istawla ala al-makhluqat. Right? Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arsh istawa, if you wanted to do ta'wil, would mean Ar-Rahman, Allah Azza wa Jal, has conquered the entire creation under his control. This is the metaphorical meaning. Okay? This is Fakhruddin al-Razi. And then he concludes the book by saying, هَذَا هُوَ الْقَانُونَ الْكُلِّ. This is the universal rule. قانون الكلي. This is the universal rule that is used in all unclear matters that conflict with Aql and Naql. So, Fakhruddin al-Razi promotes something that he calls Al-Qanun al-Kulli. And by the way, in my PhD dissertation, I showed that this is in fact, with all respect to Fakhruddin al-Razi, it is not his idea. These are the ideas of Al-Ghazali before him. And Fakhruddin al-Razi literally cuts and pastes from Ghazali. And in those days, they would not even reference a lot of times. And al-Ghazali has a book called Al-Qanun al-Kulli fi al-Ta'wil. He has an entire treatise, right? And this booklet, literally al-Razi simply cuts and pastes and rehashes and whatnot, and then does it in his own word. Even the name Al-Qanun al-Kulli comes from al-Ghazali. And in that book, al-Ghazali says that, know, may Allah have mercy on you, that... If any intellectual proof establishes something and a textual proof goes against it, we have to yutasallat, which means give sultan or give authority to the intellectual proof over the textual proof. right? So al-Ghazali, in his treatise al-Qanun Kulli fi al-Ta'wil, he basically produces this entire concept, and then Fakhruddin al-Razi then takes it and then puts it in his Asas al-Taqdis and popularizes it. And for some reason, al-Ghazali's treatise is not that well known compared to his other books, whereas Fakhruddin al-Razi's Asas al-Taqdis is very, very famous. So this is the raison d'etre, or the reason why Ibn Taymiyyah wrote his Ta'aruf. So Ibn Taymiyyah, of course, I don't need an introduction to who Ibn Taymiyyah is. Ibn Taymiyyah, just a very, very brief introduction to the thought of Ibn Taymiyyah and what he represents. Ibn Taymiyyah comes from a family of Hanbali scholars. His father and his grandfather were both very famous Hanbali scholars, and he was born in the ancient city of Harran, which is in modern Turkey. And the Mongols, Genghis Khan's forces, invaded, and so his parents were forced to flee and take him to Damascus, which was one of the intellectual capitals of the Muslim world at the time. So he grew up and he was raised and he studied in Damascus. His father died when he was a teenager. So Ibn Taymiyyah took over his father's position, teaching position in the masjid at the age of 18 or 19. He became the teacher of the main Hanbali masjid of Damascus. And he was a neophyte. He was a very intellectual person at a young age. He was a polymath. He mastered all of the sciences of Islam. And he did something, and this is really what sets Ibn Taymiyyah apart from the previous Hanbalis. He did something that the previous Hanabil or the previous Athari scholars never did. And that is, he read the works of his opponents. The previous Hanbali scholars were very close-minded in this regard. They didn't want to read the books of the philosophers or the Greeks or the Mutakallimun. They said, these are books of heresy and deviation, and don't even read them, right? They're going to pollute your mind. And therefore, if you read pre-Ibn Taymiyyah Athari books, you find them to be a whole different character. Very simplistic. Quran, Hadith, Quran, Hadith, Quran, Hadith. There's very little logic, there's very little rhetoric, there's very little development of ideas even, right? It's simply, this is what the Quran says, you have to believe it. This is what the Hadith says, you have to believe it. Very few people went against this trend. Ibn Taymiyyah was the greatest example of this. Ibn Taymiyyah spent years studying every single philosophy and ideology out there, from the Mutasawwifa to the Falasifa to Greek logic to philosophy. He read the books of Aristotle. He did everything what the previous Hanabila did not do. And this gave him a type of mind and a rhetoric and a style that is simply unprecedented, dare I say, unfollowed even after him. It is my claim that even many of those who follow Ibn Taymiyyah are not truly following Ibn Taymiyyah. This is my claim, with all respect, that many of those who think they're following Ibn Taymiyyah, they have not understood this mind, and they really cannot imitate, or they cannot walk even in his footsteps, because, in any case, that's besides the point. That's my tangents I'm going into. Nonetheless, so Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala, he took on what he perceived to be the Athari cause, but in a style or manner that was unprecedented. And as I explained why, that he exposed his mind to the ideas around him, and he began defending the Athari creed and the Athari methodology in a manner that was never seen before, and dare I say, even after him. And there's no doubt that Ibn Taymiyyah was a harsh polemicist in his writings. He was unforgiving to any other group, because he truly believed there is one Islam, that is correct Islam. And every single other theology, ideology, methodology was weighed according to the grand scales of the Quran and Sunnah as understood by the early generations of Islam, the Athari creed as he called it. And no doubt his harshest criticisms were for the falasifa and the extreme mutasawwifa, such as Ibn Arabi and Hallaj and Ibn Sina. No doubt these people, they had very little sympathy in the eyes of Ibn Taymiyyah. Dare I say, even Ghazali and others did not like Ibn Sina, as we all know, that they also had problems with them. But in terms of sheer quantity, the number one target of Ibn Taymiyyah is the fellow Sunni Ash'ari school. Why is this the case when they're in fact the closest creed out of all of the creeds? Why did he concentrate on the closest creed? The number one in terms of sheer quantity, groups of fatawa, treatises, monographs, he concentrated on the sister Sunni school of Ash'arism. And he acknowledges they are a Sunni school. He says in his writings that in the broad scale of things, he always says, like, generally speaking, they are in the general Sunni tradition. Yes. yet he takes them on as the number one. Why? I explained in my dissertation, and that's just a footnote for here, but you can read this inshallah whenever the dissertation is published. I explained the reason for this is in the previous 150 years prior to Ibn Taymiyyah, the Ash'ari school rose from being something very small, very insignificant in Nishapur. It became in 150 years the dominant Sunni Islam. And that's an interesting subject of history that's beyond the scope of this class. But 300 years before Ibn Taymiyyah, the Athari school was really the main representation of Sunni Islam. And in Baghdad, it was the prominent. The Khalifa himself was a hardcore, if you like, Athari. And there are creeds that clearly show this, right? When the Ash'ari creed was introduced to Baghdad, it caused a major chaos, a major problem. It's called the Fitna of Qushayri. A major problem took place, and it took over 150 years for this creed to gain political dominance over the Athari creed. When Ibn Taymiyyah comes, his creed is now the underdog. His creed is now the minority creed, the Athari creed. So he feels the need to defend it from its main competitor. And the main competitor was not Shi'ism or Sufism or Greek philosophy. The main competitor obviously was Ash'arism, right? And that explains his motivation for concentrating on this claim. Nonetheless, let us move now to Dar al-Ta'arud and really just jump into this book, Dar al-Ta'arud. Dar al-Ta'arud, by the way, is one of the largest books Ibn Taymiyyah ever wrote. Ibn Taymiyyah wrote many treatises, many fatawa. You know, and I'm sure somewhere over here you have the books of Ibn Taymiyyah. They take up 7-8 shelves in modern print. I mean, I have in my library literally this an entire 2 sections like this is Ibn Taymiyyah, just Ibn Taymiyyah, right? And one of the largest books he wrote is Dar al-Ta'arud al-Aql wa al-Naql. This is one of the largest. In modern prints, it's around 10 or 11 prints, depending which print you have, 10 or 11 volumes in modern prints. And the title of this book, Dar al-Ta'arud al-Aql wa al-Naql, he named it himself, and it translates as, in English, averting the conflict of reason with scripture. Dar'u ta'arud. Dar' means averting, making sure it doesn't happen. Ta'arud is a clash. Al-aql wa naql, aql and naql we've already done. And in another writing, he calls it muwafaqatu, or the reconciliation of the explicit scripture, al-naql al-sarih, with the correct intellect, al-aql al-sahih. Al-naql al-sarih, muwafaqat al-aql al-sarih bil-naql al-aql al-sahih bil-naql al-sarih. Right? The reconciliation or the bringing together of explicit scripture with correct intellect. And so you understand automatically the philosophy of Ibn Taymiyyah is going to be very different than the philosophy of Ar-Razi, who's positing a conflict and what is to be done in the case of the conflict. And I'm going to summarize for the rest of the talk. I'll really summarize Dar al-Ta'arud, the 10 volumes, which I have done in my PhD much longer. The good news, alhamdulillah, I have submitted my PhD to Yale. So inshallah, inshallah, within a few weeks, inshallah, I'll be sharing the good news with all of you. So I'm a big burden off my chest, as anybody who's gone through this phase knows. Alhamdulillah, I feel very free today. It is last week, I said, very fresh, alhamdulillah.
So we can celebrate today.
inshallah. Technically, there's still 3 weeks left to get the final verdict, but inshallah, it's just a technicality. As I was saying in the dissertation, I go into a lot of detail, obviously, and I have around 100-something pages summarizing the entire 10 volumes. Obviously, I'm not going to bore you with 100 pages, but I will summarize some of the key points. What does Ibn Taymiyyah do in this book? The very first page, he quotes Fakhruddin al-Razi's final paragraph, which is Al-Qanun al-Kulli. He quotes it verbatim. He says, Fakhruddin al-Razi says, da-da-da-da-da. He's telling you exactly what the book is about. It's a refutation of Al-Qanun al-Kulli, right? What is Al-Qanun al-Kulli? Basically, إِذَا تَعَارَضَ الْعَقْلُ وَالنَّقْلُ وَجَبَ تَقْدِيمُ الْعَقْلِ عَلَى النَّقْلِ. This is in a khulasa, in a summary. If عَقْل and نَقْل are at odds, we have to prefer aql over naql and interpret naql according to aql. Clear so far, right? This is Ibn Taymiyyah's main beginning, that he quotes Fakhruddin al-Razi. Then he commences and he says that this exercise or this issue of interpreting aql with naql, he says this is the cornerstone of all heresy and ilhad and deviation. This is the premise that every single group basically messes up from. This is the fountain from which heresy stems. And he says there's a generic way of refuting this, and there's a specific way. And the generic way, he begins by talking overall that this is simply not what Islam is about. And he mentions, if you look at it historically, this is exactly what the previous groups did. And he mentions a detailed analysis of Christianity. Ibn Taymiyyah, by the way, we all know, was an expert in Christian polemics. One of his largest books was the refutation of Christianity, al-Jawab al-Sahih liman baddala deen al-Masih, right? By the way, my own elder, Muzammil Siddiqui, whom I always joke, he's leading the way because he graduated from Medina, then went to Harvard. I graduated from Medina, then went to Yale. So his PhD at Harvard was on al-Jawab al-Sahih liman baddala deen al-Masih, right, back in the 70s. And then my PhD at Yale is Ibn Taymiyyah's Dar al-Ta'arud. So it's an interesting... we didn't plan this, by the way. I wasn't even born when he was at Harvard. So this was not something planned, but subhanAllah.
But you planned being Pakistani.
Ah, yes, of course. Yeah. Alhamdulillah. So he says this is exactly what the Christians did with their religion. How so? He says Christians formulated their doctrines via their councils. You all know the Council of Nicaea, the Council of this, the Council of that. Then they took these doctrines as their asl. Then they viewed their naql in light of these asl. And they read in the Trinity. They read in the redemption. They read in the original sin, even though the scripture is silent about these matters or it is ambiguous about these matters. And they took these qawaneen or these conventions that they held, the councils that they held, right? And they made them their intellectual asl. And so he said, this is exactly what the other groups are attempting to do as well. And he then begins a detailed refutation. What is the detailed refutation? 44 points in 10 volumes. And I'm not going to go over all 44. He goes 44. The first one, he literally has all 44 points. We're going to mention probably around 10 of them. And then I will summarize all 44 in a page. That was one of the main things I did for the dissertation, to group all of these 44 into broader motifs. So we're going to summarize basically 10 of these 44 in the next 10 minutes, inshallah, or 15 minutes, we'll see. He says, of these 44 ways, the binary distinction of evidence into either rational or scriptural is false. Aqli or naqli is false. This is an incorrect way of viewing the world. You're already setting up a clash. Rather, he says, evidences are looked at in weight of their indubitability, their yaqeen status. And if the aql is yaqeen, we will give precedence to the aql because not it is aql, but it is yaqeen. And if the naql is yaqeen, we will give precedence to the naql, not because it is naql, but rather because it is yaqeen. We should not differentiate between aql and naql in terms of acceptance. Rather, we look at the weight of each evidence, independent of what it... And wallahi, this is, if you think about it, it's a very profound point here. This is not an ad hominem attack. Is it aqli or naqli? You weigh it based upon its own evidence. And then you accept or you reject. So he says... The very positing of this binary, setup, the very positing of this binary demarcation is false. Rather, an evidence is judged based upon its own merit, regardless of its aql or its naql, right? He then says that the claim that aql is the basis and foundation for accepting naql, so pause here, I need to give you a footnote, so let's pause for a second. Ash'ari theology has a very set way of going about creed. Number one, you start with a tabula rasa. Your mind is blank, right? So you have to rationally prove a God exists. And then you have to rationally prove that he sends prophets. And then you prove that the prophet has to bring miracles. Then you prove that the prophet Muhammad is a true prophet. Then you accept the faith, right? Because they didn't want blind faith. Because blind faith, iman al-muqallid, the majority, even though there's a bit of a distinction within the Ash'ari school, iman al-muqallid is something that is frowned upon or maybe even not even accepted. So you have to, as the Ash'ari textbooks say, awwalu wajibin ala al-mukallaf, an-nazar, or wujub an-nazar, or al-qasdu ila an-nazar, awwalu wajibin ala al-mukallaf, an-nazar. The first thing that the rationally sane adult has to do is to reason his faith out, right? So the point that Ar-Razi is saying, if this is aql and this is naql, so aql has to be before naql, because aql leads us to naql, right? Now, if we find that contradiction and then we reject the aql, we're actually rejecting the naql as well. Ibn Taymiyyah says, your claim that aql is a precursor to naql, this is the Ash'ari claim, your claim is aql is a precursor to naql is not correct. This is not correct. Rather, what naql posits is independent of aql. What Allah and His Messenger says is true regardless of whether you know it or don't, or whether your aql understands it or not. And then he brings an interesting point here, and he says, what these scholars mean is the truth of the scripture for them is dependent upon their aql, not the truth of the scripture ultimately. This is a very profound point, right? The truth of the scripture cannot be dependent on my mind or your mind. This is kalamullah. Rather, they are saying for them, the truth of the scripture is dependent on their aql. So they need to understand this point, that in fact, their aql will not add any characteristic to the naql that it doesn't independently possess. In other words, whether Fulan or Fulan accepts or rejects the Quran, it will not change the Quran as kalamullah. This is an interesting point here. Whether so-and-so or so-and-so accepts or rejects, actuality, the kalamullah will remain independent of what any one man or one shaitan or one shaitan rejects it, so what? Doesn't change the characteristics of the Quran. Rather, they need to understand, as he's saying, that they are being very subjective. That the truth of naql, according to them, is dependent on their aql. Yes, this is true. Not that the truth of naql unconditionally is dependent on their aql. Right? So he basically says, put yourself in your place. He doesn't say it so bluntly, but basically what he's saying, right? He then moves on and he says, and this is one of the main points of the Dar al-Ta'aruf, what exactly do you mean by aql? What exactly do you mean by aql? If by aql you mean the internal instinct, in Arabic, the ghariza, that people possess, then this supposition is completely false, because this internal instinct is not capable of contradicting the scripture. If by aql you mean the acquired knowledge, physics, mathematics, chemistry, this is acquired knowledge, right? Then even in this case, we say this is not correct. Why? Because, and he goes into a lot of details here, number one, he says, acquired knowledge varies from time to time, place to place, person to person. And what one person deems to be intellect today, he himself will discover tomorrow is not intellect. And what one society deems to be intellect today, the other society will come and say, it is not intellect tomorrow. And so historically, intellectual solid proofs, right? Especially, he says, of an ethical and a religious nature that are derived from the aql, change. And this is historically, you cannot deny this. Another point he brings, he says, one of the biggest problems of Fakhruddin al-Razi and the Ash'ari school, he says, and all of the other schools, is to make aql one big, undivisible entity. And he says, this is simply wrong. What proved the truth of naql is one part of all of what you have. One section of your aql. It proved to you the Prophet ﷺ is a prophet. Now, what is coming from the Prophet might contradict another section of your aql, not the section that proved he is a prophet. So he's dividing aql into a lot of mini parts. And he's saying, the part that proved he's a prophet is something nothing to do with Allah's names and attributes conflicting with this issue, or Allah's qadr that you don't understand, or this or that. It's another part, basically, of there. So you're not positing a clash of aql and naql. Rather, you're positing a clash of one naql with another element of aql that's independent of what affirmed the naql in the first place. Is that clear, or should I go back? I'm sometimes using too much, going too fast sometimes. It's my problem is I speak too fast. He also says that this is a contradiction in thought, because you either know that the Prophet ﷺ is a true prophet or not. If he is a true prophet, then aql demands that you accept him for everything that he says. If he's not a true prophet, then there is no clash in the first place. You cannot posit a clash between something you don't believe in versus something you do believe in, right? If you don't believe he's a prophet, there is no clash. So he says, you are contradicting yourself because, and he says here, it is as if you are telling yourself, do not believe what you know must be true, because it shall conflict with your knowledge of the truthfulness of the person who's speaking. Let me say that again. What he's saying is, you end up rejecting the Prophet ﷺ because you didn't want to reject him. Think about that. Why did you reject this hadith? He's telling the Ash'ari. Because to accept it means you're going to reject him as a prophet, right? Right? You see the circularity here? Let me go back again then, okay? Ar-Razi's main point is, if I accept something that is intellectually unfeasible for me to accept, I am in fact impugning my intellect when it tells me this man is a prophet of Allah. If my intellect is wrong about this particular hadith or ayah, maybe it's wrong about he's a prophet and this is the book of God. So in order for me not to reject the Prophet ﷺ, I have to reject the Prophet ﷺ. Do you see, this is what Ibn Taymiyyah is saying. In order for me not to reject the Prophet ﷺ, I have to reject this hadith from the Prophet ﷺ. And you end up doing exactly what you said you don't want to do in the first place. Right? And he says this is obviously a logical fallacy. He also says, this is the sixth point. Again, I'm summarizing very briefly. Obviously, each point is 5 pages, 10 pages. Sometimes some points are 700 pages. So obviously, I'm just summarizing it in a bit. He also says, the opposite, were it to be said, is closer to the truth than the qanun al-kulli. Were it to be said, the opposite. What is the opposite? إِذَا تَعَارَضَ الْعَقْلُ وَالنَّقْلُ وَجَبَ تَقْدِيبُ النَّقْلِ عَلَى الْعَقْلِ. If aql and naql conflict, in fact, we should give precedence to naql over aql. He says, if we were to say this, he doesn't say this, if we were to say this, it would make more logical and rational sense. Why? Because he says, it is clear that the aql proved the naql to be true and valid overall. So when it finds a particular issue that it doesn't understand, it would make sense to simply accept this issue and acknowledge the limitations of the aql. Because the aql has confirmed the validity of the naql generically. But the naql has not confirmed the validity of every aql. You see, it's a one-way street here. It's a one-way street. We know the Quran to be Kalamullah. Once we come across an ayah we don't understand, aql tells us that now that we know Quran is Kalamullah, khalas, we accept it then. This is our aql should tell us this. And he gives a beautiful example. He says, imagine a stranger goes to a city and he has a fiqh question. He wants to ask a mufti. So he finds somebody in the masjid. He says, you know, can you tell me where is the mufti? So he says, I'm going to take you to our main mufti, the best mufti of the town. Holds him by the hand, takes him to the mufti. The stranger asks the mufti the question. The mufti gives his fatwa. Then on the way back, the guy who took him there said, no, you know what? The mufti is wrong. I'm sorry, I don't agree with the mufti. The mufti is wrong. So the man will say, but you told me he's the mufti. Yeah, but this doesn't make sense. You have to follow my opinion. The man will say, no, this is Ibn Taymiyyah speaking now. No, the fact that you testified he is the mufti and the best mufti of the town means that this is the person whose fatwa I need to take. And the fact that you disagreed with one fatwa from him does not strip away your earlier testimony that he is the grand mufti of the town. And this is the role of the aql and the naql. For Ibn Taymiyyah, obviously. That the aql says the naql is kalamullah. So if one particular ayah or issue is not understood, then it doesn't take away from the fact that the aql did testify it is kalamullah. Okay, and that's an interesting point that he brings. He also says that if one allows there to be a conflict between aql and naql, and these conflicts, they always occur in areas that are not purely intellectual. I find this very profound. He says, never does a conflict occur with something that is purely mathematical or calculations or science. Rather, you posit conflicts in ethics, in God's attributes, right? In philosophical issues. So he says, if clear-cut aql, which is mathematics, he goes, the clearest aqli science is mathematics. This is what Ibn Taymiyyah said. The clearest intellectual science is mathematics, right? If mathematics can never contradict the Quran, and science, he says, can never contradict the Quran, you expect there to be contradictions in the finer issues of ethics and theology? This does not make any sense. He also brings another point, and he says, whoever opens this door of one issue being problematic to potentially something aqli, opens the door for every issue being problematic to something aqli. In other words, he says, and this is a very long point that he says, that the Asha'ira find God's attributes problematic in the Quran, according to Ibn Taymiyyah, obviously, you know, because he's athariqi. The Asha'ira find God's attributes problematic, so they will reinterpret all of the sifat the way that they need to reinterpret them. He says, what is there to stop others from finding another issue problematic that is not problematic today when aql finds or discovers something else? Because aql, he says, changes. Aql tatawwar. Aql keeps on expanding its horizons, right? So if you open up this door, you're not going to be able to shut it. This is the floodgate argument, right? And then he points out, and this is a very deep point, that it is contradictory to use this rule in one area and not in another. So the Asha'ira use it in God's names and attributes, and yet he says the same Asha'ira, such as Ar-Razi and Al-Ghazali, when the falasifa do the exact same thing to Jannah and Nar, they call them kafir. Now this is true, you know this. Al-Ghazali, in his Tahafud fil Falasifa, what does he do? Right? Al-Ghazali says, because Ibn Sina denies Jannah and Nar and resurrection and bodily and whatnot, because he denies it and he makes ta'wil of it, right? He's not a Muslim. And Ibn Taymiyyah, of course, agrees with Al-Ghazali's analysis of Ibn Sina, obviously. You know this point. I mean, I'm not saying anything new to you. So he says, but you are doing the exact same thing in one area that they're doing in another, which is taking explicit scripture and finding it to be problematic with an intellectual premise, and then reinterpreting based on this one intellectual premise hundreds of ayat and hadith. This is double standards, that you consider them to be kafir, but you consider this to be legit to yourself just because the area involves Allah's names and attributes, or qadr, or predestination. Whereas they're doing it to Jannah and Nar, resurrection, qiyamah, right? And basically all Sunni scholars and even mainstream Shia scholars said, anybody who denies al-qiyamah, I mean, obviously, yani, one of the pillars of faith is qiyamah, you know? Anybody who denies al-ba'th wa al-nushur and whatnot, and you really cannot be called a believer in the scripture, right? And this is a ijma' point amongst scholars of Islam. And we all know that many of the philosopha, they really denied an actual ba'th and nushur. They said this is metaphysical or you know, something khayali or takhiri or something. So he is saying, but the ayat of Allah's attributes are more in number than the ayat of Jannah and Nar. So you're doing this to a quantity and quality of verses even more than what they are, and yet you think this is permissible. There is something that is a problem over here. Another point of his is, and we'll just go two more points and then summarize and then open the floor for Q&A, inshallah. I have a lot that can be said. And you caught me at a time where the PhD is fresh in my memory, right? Had you invited me, inshallah, 10, 20 years from now, the PhD would now be long gone, you know, like whatever it was. But I have just reviewed the 370 pages. I've reviewed it like 8 times in the last, you know, 20 days, you know, going over it, whatnot. So it's all now, I can probably quote you the page numbers, you know, stuff for a lot at this stage. So another point that he mentions is that, which aql are you referring to? Which group's aql? And then he makes a really sarcastic comment. I think it's sarcastic, he doesn't say it. He goes, if you look at the Mu'tazili and the Asha'ira, they have, mashallah, tabarakallah, so much aql amongst them. And yet, no two amongst them end up agreeing with each other. And then he starts quoting, look at al-Allāh, look at al-Nazam, look at al-Razi, look at al-Armawi, look at al-Ghazali. And he has a detailed analysis of like 15, 20 theologians, right? This guy refuted that guy refuted this guy, and this is all aqli proofs. Right, so he said, فَبِأَيِّ عَقْلٍ يُوزَنُ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ. Which aql do you want me to choose from amongst these uqul? Which aql do you want me to choose to judge the book and the sunnah? So he makes a somewhat of a mockery that you consider yourselves to be people of intellect. You would think, this is Ibn Taymiyyah writing, that if aql was one thing that was unanimous, all of these intellectual people, uqala, would agree upon something. But the fact of the matter is that each group amongst them differs with each other. So the Mu'tazila believe intellectually that this is possible from Allah, this is not possible. The Ash'ari believe intellectually this is possible, this is not possible. The philosopher believe. And then within each group, you have a whole spectrum. And there is nothing that combines between every single scholar of every single one of these groups that they call intellectual. So intellectual becomes whatever you think is the truth, and you just call it aqli. This is what Ibn Taymiyyah says. That for these types of people, intellectual is simply what you believe to be the truth, because there is no uniform consensus about what type of aql can be agreed upon. One of his motifs as well is that of the repentant philosopher or the repentant mutakallim. And Ibn Taymiyyah brings this up in many of his books, and he really loves doing this. And he says, the majority of the scholars of falsafa and kalam that were sincere, they repented towards the end of their lives. And they realized that this is not the correct way. That we were doing something that caused more doubt and confusion. And in particular, he loves quoting Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari himself. As you know, he went through a number of phases, and he wrote Al-Ibana at the end of his life. And Al-Ghazali. And Al-Ghazali, when he passed away, he was reading Sahih al-Bukhari, if you remember. And he basically said, you know, this is my aqidah in this book, Al-Bukhari. And Al-Juwayni. And Al-Juwayni, he advised his students, according to Ibn Taymiyyah, he advised his students that don't enter into this philosophical kalam that I went into, because it has destroyed me, any type of destroying, any ayyama tadmir, it's really messed me up. And Fakhruddin al-Razi, and Fakhruddin al-Razi, by the way, he wrote a wasiyya at the end of his life in the year 1210 CE. And this wasiyya is actually preserved in Konya, in Turkey. His wasiyya, Fakhruddin al-Razi, is actually preserved. And it is printed, and you find it also in the biographies of Ar-Razi. It's a three-page wasiyya. And in it, he writes a poem at the end of it. Nihayatu ilm al-kalami iqadu. That the end result of this ilm al-kalam, or this intellectual tangent that I went into, is iqal, which is hampering. It's brought me back, right? وَحَاسِلُ دُنْيَانَا قِيلَ وَقَالُوا. All that we got from all of this was, he said this, he said that. He said this, he said that. قِيلَ وَقَالُوا. Right? And he kept on going, and then Fakhruddin al-Razi writes that, I read the Qur'an, and nothing was clearer in theology than the Qur'an. اِقْرَأْ فِي الْإِثْبَاتِ الرَّحْمَنُ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ اسْتَوَى وَقْرَأْ فِي النَّفِي لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Read Allah's attributes when He affirms He is such and such, وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. He writes a few examples. And then read the negation, there is nothing like Him. لَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. Simple enough, leave it at that. This is his wasiyya that he ran. It's actually a valid wasiyya. We actually, when we were at Yale, we took a class in Fakhruddin al-Razi, and so we actually got this copy of the wasiyya and read it. So it's a valid wasiyya. He wrote it himself, and it's found in all of the documents that mention Fakhruddin al-Razi's biography. And so he's actually expressing a regret that, you know, I wasted my entire life just going into this philosophical tangent. Nothing is better and simpler than the Qur'an. This is what Ibn Taymiyyah revels in. Quoting Al-Ghazali, quoting Ar-Razi, quoting Al-Juwayni, all of them saying towards the end of their life, they repented. So why don't you follow their repentance? That's what he's telling his readers as well. Ibn Taymiyyah also says that much of what you claim to be intellectual is not intellectual. Rather, this is dhanni. Much of what you claim to be intellectual is not intellectual, it is dhanni. And this is I found this very interesting, what Ibn Taymiyyah wrote. And he says, you have purposefully and intentionally obfuscated these concepts with difficult language, with a type of rhetoric and a type of writing that the average beginner finds difficult to read. And when a person challenges you with something that is very trivial and basic, you simply dismiss it as, oh, you don't understand, and this is too complicated for you, right? And so the young student, feeling insulted, simply swallows up his It's, you know, the story of the emperor, the naked emperor. You know the what is it? The kid and the emperor without any clothes. What is it? Right. That. So this is Ibn Taymiyyah's version of that. Okay. That when some innocent young student comes along and asks some really probing questions that exposes this all to be false, because there's now, according to Ibn Taymiyyah, a clique. There's now a group. There's now a guild. Right. If he wants admittance to this guild, the guild has to approve his admittance. How do they do it? You have to be a member of the guild. It's a circular thing, right? So Ibn Taymiyyah says, and I found this really intriguing, they intentionally obfuscate, and they write in difficult language, and they bring about issues that are of little, you know, validity. And so the neophyte, the beginning student, simply agrees to acquiesce, to just bow down, because he wants to be admitted to the guild, right? And this is basically Ibn Taymiyyah's version of the emperor with no clothes. And then I just want to conclude with summarizing. So just an example here, all of the 44 points, what I did was I summarized them into broader motifs in one page, basically, right? So I'll just conclude with these broader motifs, and then inshallah, leave the floor for Q&A with some personal thoughts about how this is relevant in modern times. I summarized Ibn Taymiyyah's 44 points into, let us just say, primarily six points. All of these 44 can be categorized into six. The first primary attack of Ibn Taymiyyah, I called it faith-based arguments. 17 of the 44 arguments are faith-based. And by faith-based, we mean that either involving the Quran or involving the role of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So for example, he says that if the Prophet has spoken definitively, then nothing can possibly contradict him. To do so undermines the truth of his prophethood. If he is truly Rasulullah, then he is speaking the truth. To say that for him, he says, the essence of Islam is istislam, submission. We all know this. The real meaning of Islam is actually submission, as we know. The essence of Islam is submission to Allah and his Prophet. Hence, he says, a conditional belief in the Prophet ﷺ is not belief in the Prophet ﷺ. He's very firm about this point. I will believe in him as long as my aql agrees, and then I'll disagree with the rest of it. Right? This is not belief. Any conditional belief in the Prophet ﷺ is not belief. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُ ثُمَّ لَا يَجُدُ فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. The Quran is very explicit, right? Complete submission to the Prophet ﷺ. Anyone, and he mentions examples, anytime a chieftain or a Bedouin came and said, I will believe in you as long as you make me the king after you, right? I will believe in you as long as you give me half of the power after you, Musaylim and whatnot, right? He mocks this. He goes, this isn't belief, and that's why their belief was rejected. Their belief was not belief because it was conditional belief. And any belief that is conditional cannot be a belief in the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He also says, again, the purpose of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was to explain the very theological issues that the falasifa and the mutakallimun find problematic. That was his role, to explain ilm al-ghayb to the greatest extent that we need to know. And the very role of the Prophet is being diminished when you say we cannot accept him in these areas. Ibn Taymiyyah also says that the Quran, so this is also faith-based still, the Quran describes itself as being the source of guidance, a light, a mercy, in clear Arabic, bilisan and arabiyyin mubeen, we have made the Quran easy to understand, yet you are claiming that the Quran is contradictory. It's a book of symbols, it's a book of interpretations, and the Quran never calls itself in this manner. The Quran itself criticizes those who consider its message to be misguided. It criticizes people of the book for doing to their books what the people of the Qanun al-Kulli are doing to the Quran. Right? أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعَ الْكِتَابِ دَكُنْ بَعَ Right? يُحَرِّفُونَ الْكَلِمَ عَمَّا وَاضِعِهِ Right? It's changing it, doing this, right? Adding, subtracting. All of this has been criticized. When you say that aql and naql will have a conflict, you're going to have to do the same to the Quran as they did to their scriptures before them. So these are all faith-based arguments, and essentially what he is saying is to believe in the Qanun makes belief in the Quran and Sunnah meaningless. To say that aql will be over naql makes naql useless. That's the faith-based argument. The second of these six arguments that will that I summarize them in is that he attacks the premises of the qanun and the structure of its wording. And an example of this, we said, is to make this binary distinction of aqli versus naqli is wrong. This is incorrect from the very get-go. He claims that one of the main problems, the a priori assumption of the mutakallimun, that the Qur'an cannot be understood properly. The Qur'an is symbolic. The Qur'an is always difficult to understand. This is an assumption. Whereas he says this is an incorrect premise. بِلِسَانٍ عَرَبِيٍ مُبِينٍ. Right, Allah Azza wa Jal says, "Inna anzalna Quran Arabiya, la'allakum ta'qilun, la'allakum tatakkarun." We've made the Quran in easy Arabic or in clear Arabic. Yasin wa Quran al-Hakim. So the entire description of the Quran, fahal min mudakkir, and an a priori assumption of the mutakallimun, the Quran is complex, it's elastic, it's bendable, it's this and that. Whereas according to the Quran is saying it's understandable. Right. So this assumption he challenges from the mutakallimun. Moving on to the third of the six, at least eight of those 44 points, and this is one of the main concepts of the dar, is his critique of defining reason and rationality. What is aql? This is eight of those 44 points are attacking what is aql. Aql, according to Ibn Taymiyyah, is not one single indivisible entity. Rather, every group differs in its understanding and definition of what is aql. Additionally, he says, aqli judgments are not absolute, but rather relative. What is aqli for one person is not aqli for another. What is aqli for one time is not aqli for another. What is aqli in one context will not be aqli in another context. Rather, it is revelation that is unchanging ila yawm al-qiyamah. And aql will change. And then he says, much of what is assumed to be aqli on further inspection is found to be dhanni. It's simply hawa, it's simply your desires that you couch in pseudo-intellectual language that in fact is not actually scientific or it's not actually intellectual. And in fact, he goes, can even be shown to be irrational or contradictory. What is even more convincing for Ibn Taymiyyah is that the people who follow this qanun, the people who follow this qanun seem to contradict the Quran and Sunnah in areas that are pseudo-scientific, such as theology, and not in areas that are actually scientific, such as mathematics, as we said, and astronomy and whatnot. Because the Quran can never contradict. Now, by the way, this is a big issue in our times of terms of evolution, right? But in Ibn Taymiyyah's time, they had not ever found anything that scientifically contradicted the Quran. In our days, we can add a footnote here. Ibn Taymiyyah was not aware, obviously, of the controversy of evolution. But this is a major issue in our times. How do we reconcile? And that's a whole different tangent. But I'm saying, frankly, before the theory of evolution, you know, clashed with the Quran, really it was almost impossible to find a scientifically solid yaqini evidence that contradicted with anything that was clearly Quranic. And I believe that the theory of evolution is the very first time in our history. And it's a, that's why a very big deal for us. We need to, it's a different tangent. It's a very difficult. And I had a debate 2 months ago in London. If it's online, you can talk. You can see my views on that. But I don't think in the history of our religion we have ever come across something that is as scientifically solid as the theory of evolution, and yet still seems to go against the explicit scripture. So when Ibn Taymiyyah is writing, he can write confidently that, look, the physical sciences, mathematics, chemistry, biology, they have never contradicted the Quran and Sunnah, and yet you're claiming that pseudoscience, because theology is not actual science, right? Theology is not an intellectual science the way that biology is, right? Theology is something that you really think about. It's a philosophical science, right? So he is saying you're positing a clash in these sciences, and yet the explicit sciences never have a clash, right? So this is another point of Ibn Taymiyyah's. And then the final point that we'll mention is that the qanun brings about objectionable corollaries, the mustalzimat, or the necessary ramifications of the qanun. He says that if each and every text from the Quran must be verified from the aql, then you have compromised the integrity of the whole Quran. And in fact, it makes the revelation of the Quran superfluous. Who needs it then? If always aql is going to be judging every single ayah, what was the purpose of revealing the Quran then? He also says that this would lead to every single individual having a unique Islam of his own. Because every person's aqal would be something different. Every person would have an own unique Islam, and this would also make following the Prophet ﷺ basically superfluous. There's no need for Allah Azza wa Jal to have sent a prophet, and thereby the whole point of wahi or revelation seems to go into a meaningless. And there are other points as well, and I just want to conclude with something that I found very interesting, and then from here we'll just mention why I believe this is useful in our times. In point number 38 out of the 44, Ibn Taymiyyah has a brief paragraph which I found very profound for modern Islam. Point number 38, Ibn Taymiyyah says, it is established that al-masail al-ilmiyyah are superior to and more important than al-masail al-amaliyyah. Theology is more important than law. And this, it goes as, you know, everybody agrees to this, and then just moves on. It's a given. And in Ibn Taymiyyah's time, that was the case. It's a given. What are the Mu'tazila and the Asha'ir and the Atharis and the Shia all arguing over? Not fiqh. We all know Shi'i fiqh, Mu'tazili fiqh, Hanafi fiqh, Shafi'i fiqh overlap in 99 or 95% of the areas, right? Ja'fari fiqh is not that different than Hanafi fiqh in most of its laws. Right? That's not what separates Shi'ism, Mu'tazilism, Sunnism. What separates these are theology, Aqidah. And Ibn Taymiyyah takes it as a given. He doesn't even need to prove it because it's something well known. Al-Masail al-Ilmiyyah are superior to Al-Masail al-Amaliyyah. And then he goes in and you guys are positing a clash with Masail al-Ilmiyyah. That's not relevant to what I wanted to say. I wanted to say, in the 21st century, it's flipped around. What we are witnessing, this is my personal ideas, take it or leave it. What we are witnessing is a complete changing of this simple paradigm that the bulk of the Ummah lived with and throughout. In our times, theology has really taken on a back burner. We really are not that interested, by and large, about what you believe about God's names and attributes, about imama, about qadr. These are done controversies. What are the hot topics of our times? Sexuality, women's roles, fiqh issues, freedom. These are the topics of our times. Democracy, systems of government, right? And I just found it interesting that, again, this is just, you know, we need to take a step back and look at overall what's happening in history, right? That What we are interested in now are issues that by and large were not very interesting or givens or considered to be facts, you know, 100, 1,000 years ago. And I'll conclude with this point. No doubt, I am not just a person who studies Ibn Taymiyyah. I'll be very frank. I definitely admire the guy. I consider him to be one of my main intellectual mentors, and I find his arguments very deep and very profound. And yes, I am sympathetic to much of his claims as well. At the same time, obviously he is a human and we have to take and reject things that he says like every other intellectual thinker. At the same time, and let me be very frank here, and this is my own personal opinion, there's no doubt that we're facing some tensions between various strands of Islam. We call them conservative, ultra-conservative, liberal, progressive, modernistic. These are all tensions regarding amali issues, not aqadi issues. We really don't even care about what you think about Allah's names and attributes anymore, right? What is your view about women's rights? What is your views about sexuality? What is your views about homosexuality? What is your views about freedom? These are how we pigeonhole each other, let's be frank here. These are how we put boxes into each other and whatnot, right? Now, Ibn Taymiyyah's arguments, even though the concepts might no longer be relevant of Asma al-Sifat, the arguments still stand. And anybody who wishes to bring about change in Islamic thought does need to understand the appeal of figures like Ibn Taymiyyah over the masses. Why is it that he has been so popular? Ibn Taymiyyah managed to redeem aql while keeping naql supreme. Ibn Taymiyyah praised aql, he didn't dismiss it. But he said, Aql tells us to follow Naql. And in the process, he kept the both of them respectable. He said, in essence, that just like man reaches his pinnacle when he submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, similarly, the Aql reaches its pinnacle when it knows its limits and submits to the text of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And frankly, anybody who wants to bring about some radical change in the Nusus needs to understand that you are following exactly the same issues Ibn Taymiyyah raised about changing the entire structure of the Nusus, bringing the Nusus, making them superfluous. What is the purpose of these Nusus anymore, right? And let me give you a very controversial example, and I'm not going to take sides here, I'm just going to give you an example with this. One of the issues that I have to face with a lot, and it's very difficult, wallahi, the modern world that we live in, the issue of same-sex marriage, as we know, has now become a human rights issue around the world, right? And to say anything wrong about same-sex marriages, to say even it's immoral, just to say it is immoral, right? You are viewed literally as a racist. This is what it is now developing. And it's only a matter of time where literally everybody will think, if you believe this, you are like a racist, right? Now, this is a huge problem in our times. For us, at least for me, let me say, as a Muslim, it's a huge problem because in my opinion, the Quran is very clear on this issue. In my opinion, the Quran is explicit, the Sunnah is explicit, Ijma' is explicit. Human fitrah is very clear. I mean, in my opinion, there's not much debate that a serious theologian really can come and disagree with the Quran and say, well, you know, and yet we know for a fact that there are many, many groups and philosophies and intellectuals out there that are arguing for a Quranic acceptance. We're not talking about lack of violence. We all say nobody should harm them. We all agree, same wavelength. We're talking about moral acceptance, moral, right? Arguing that the story of Lut has been misinterpreted from the very beginning. That, in fact, and I know this sounds bizarre, but maybe some of you are aware of this, right? The story of Lut supports loving same-sex marriage. What is wrong is the raping same-sex marriage. That's how they interpret it, right? Now, I'm not making this up. There are very famous academics and intellectuals here in this land that are Muslims that are promoting this, right? Now, question and food for thought here. If you find that problematic, then also understand that people will find problematic other interpretations of other nusus that other groups might be dealing with as well. I.e., I'm getting back to Ibn Taymiyyah's point with the Asha'ir and the Falasifa. If the bulk of the Muslims can understand the Falasifa really seem a bit weird, man. The 10 intellects and the cosmological issues and denying Allah's knowledge. He doesn't even know who we are, and Allah is al-Aql al-Fa'al. I mean, the average Muslim reads this like, what is this? You agree, right? The average Muslim cannot accept this God, the prime mover, the unmoved mover, al-Fa'al al-Awwal, as being Allah. We understand this point. Well, from Ibn Taymiyyah's perspective, and think about this, he is saying, oh, you Muslims, he called them Muslims, see, they're Mu'tazil are Muslim, the Asha'ir are Muslim, oh, you Muslims, don't you see you're doing something very similar in your own intellectual games that those groups are doing, right? And with that point, I as well ask everyone here to think about any change that we're positing in Islam, any, you know, advancement that we want, and alhamdulillah, our religion is eternal and it is valid for every time and place, and no doubt we will fine-tune in every single circumstance, but we have to keep in mind some of these very blunt criticisms of Ibn Taymiyyah as we maneuver our way. And I'm one of those who firmly believes that yes, we need to fine-tune Islam, we need to adapt it to the time and place. But personally, this is my opinion, I don't believe we need an overhaul. I don't believe we need to change the engine. I don't believe we need to redo the Quran and Sunnah. This is my opinion. Yes, we need to fine-tune, tinker, adapt. But personally, my heart is sympathetic to what Ibn Taymiyyah wrote in this regard. And I believe that calling for a complete overhaul is making the Quran and Sunnah superfluous. There was no need then for Allah to send a book or to send a prophet. Rather, Allah sent the book and sent the prophet for a reason, to be the ultimate guides. And then He gave our intellects a realm. When we stick in those realms, Ibn Taymiyyah says perfect. But when we take the intellect to the realm that it's not supposed to be in, and we try to clash it with the Quran and Sunnah, we will end up losing both the intellect and the Quran and the Sunnah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Thank you very much, Jazakallahu khair, ya akhi, for a very stimulating presentation. And on behalf of all these groups and on behalf of Triple IT, we congratulate you on this work.